Welcome to Main Street Living. This program offers you the opportunity to participate in a worship service led by pastors and congregations of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod from your surrounding area. On today's program,
we can learn so much from blind Bartimaeus. Even though he couldn't see physically, he still knew that Jesus was his Savior from sin and called out to him for help. Bartimaeus was completely helpless. He knew he totally depended on Jesus to receive his sight and to be forgiven and have eternal life with God.
The service will begin after this opening hymn.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The epistle reading is taken from Hebrews chapter 7, verses 23 through 28. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But he holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. He has no need like those high priests to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men in their weakness as high priests, But the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. This ends the epistle reading. The Holy Gospel reading and my sermon text is taken from Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. Then they came to Jericho, and later as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a large crowd, a beggar who was blind named Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the road. And when he heard that it was Jesus the Nazarene, he began to cry out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many were sternly telling him to be quiet, but he kept crying out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and said, "Call him here." So they called the man who was blind, saying to him, "Take courage, stand up, he is calling for you." And throwing off his cloak, he jumped up and came to Jesus. And replying to him, Jesus said, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the man who was blind said to him, "Rabboni, I want to regain my sight." And Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." And immediately he regained his sight and began following him on the road. This ends the reading. We confess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for my message is from Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. This prayer of blind Bartimaeus should sound very familiar to us. We pray this prayer in the liturgy and our worship services. His prayer is the basis of our Kyrie, "Lord, have mercy upon us." "Christ, have mercy upon us." "Lord, have mercy upon us." His prayer is prayed in our prayer of the church as we conclude each petition saying, "Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer." Bartimaeus wanted Jesus to hear his prayer, his petition that Jesus would restore his sight. Of course, Jesus knew that he was calling for him to help him, and Jesus heard and answered his prayer. The blind man simply wanted to see. Jesus, knowing all things, saw into the blind man's heart and saw his faith. The blind man knew who Jesus was, for he called him the Son of David. He knew that the Messiah would come from David's line, and that the Messiah would come from Nazareth. Jesus, out of his great love for him, restored his sight. Jesus said to him, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." And as it says in verse 52, he followed Jesus on the road. His faith was not only restored his sight, but it also gave him forgiveness and eternal life in heaven. Jesus is our all-sufficient Savior. Through him, we've been given all things. Being called the Son of David meant that he was an heir to the throne of David. A king has power and authority to rule a nation. God made a promise to David that one of his sons would have an eternal rule. In Revelation chapter 19, verse 16, Jesus would be called King of Kings and Lord of Lords. His rule would be eternal in heaven, as opposed to all the earthly kings whose rule was temporary. It is King Jesus who comes to us. Jesus came to blind Bartimaeus. That is how we worship God. He comes to us when we worship him in church. Without God working in our lives, we would have no desire to worship him and to receive his blessings, which we receive in our worship services. He comes to us in worship services just as he came to Bartimaeus out on the highway. We respond saying, "Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer." He hears and answers our prayers, and we respond with songs of thankfulness and praise. Why do we ask for God's mercy? The older we get, the more obvious it is that we need God's mercy every day. Bartimaeus was blind. His need was obvious. Today we see in the bulletins of churches a list, and in some cases a long list of people who need prayers for physical healing. The list of shut-ins in many churches is quite long. The older we get, the worse is our eyesight and hearing. When I was young, I could run like the wind, but now it feels more like I am running underwater. Our bodies are not perfect, and because of sin, we eventually die. We were conceived and born in sin. We are by nature sinful and unclean, sinning against God by thought, word, and deed. But the good news is God has not forgotten us, just as he did not forget blind Bartimaeus. Jesus came to Bartimaeus and gave him what he needed. He comes to us through the word and sacraments and gives to us what we need. Even though this body will die because of sin, we have an eternal home in heaven in which there will be nothing bad forever. In speaking about heaven, the eternal home of all who believe in Jesus, Revelation 21 verses 1 through 3 says, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.'" What God has prepared for those who love him is too wonderful for us to imagine yet in this life. 2 Corinthians 2:9 says, "Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those who love him." Believers should thank God every day of our life for what we've been saved for, and also what we've been saved from. The Bible says much about the wrath to come to those who do not believe in the Savior. The Bible says that those who die without faith in Jesus will be condemned to hell forever. Jesus described hell as a furnace of fire. The Apostle John described hell as a lake of fire, and that it would last forever. What would it be like to be in a literal lake of fire forever? Revelation 20, verse 15 says, "And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." And God doesn't want that for anyone. 1 Timothy 2, verse 4 says, "God who wants all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth." That is why God comes to us through his word, the Bible, and through the sacraments. He wants all people to put their trust in Jesus and be saved. Ezekiel 33, verse 11 says, "Say to them, 'As I live, declares the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die?'" We should be so thankful that he has called us out of the darkness of unbelief and into the marvelous light of the gospel, knowing what we've been saved from and also what we've been saved for. As Jesus said to Bartimaeus, So he says to us, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Jesus later would go to Jerusalem to go to the cross to die for our sins that we might be set free. And Jesus said, if the Son shall set you free, you shall be free indeed. Jesus knew what we needed most. He knew what Bartimaeus needed at that time, and he restored his sight. Jesus knew we need forgiveness of sins. When he was on the cross, he said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. When Jesus said, it is finished, he finished the work that needed to be done to bring about our forgiveness. Only Jesus could pay the debt for our sins. Only Jesus could die in our place. As the writer to Hebrews says in our epistle for today, Jesus holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. Jesus rose from the dead that we might know that we will rise from the dead to live with God forever in heaven. Jesus then ascended into heaven and was seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, forever interceding for us, pleading for us that we might be forgiven. Because of Jesus, we can know that God hears and answers our prayers according to his own good and perfect will. Knowing what Jesus has done for us gives us reason to have great joy. Paul in Philippians 4:4 wrote, rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. The psalmist in Psalm 126 speaks of the great things that God has done for us. He says, the Lord has done great things for us. We are glad. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. He who goes out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing his sheaves with him. In our sermon text, we read that Bartimaeus was physically blind. Because of that, he was totally helpless and totally dependent on other people to take him where he needed to go. But spiritually, he could see that Jesus was the Savior. That spiritual eyesight is infinitely more important, as it promised him forgiveness and eternal life with God, where he will have perfect eyesight forever in heaven. Many of the people there that day had good eyesight to see Jesus with their physical eyes, but they were spiritually blind, unable to see that he was the Savior of the world. How sad that Jesus was right there in their midst and they didn't know it. But because Bartimaeus had heard about Jesus, he believed in him and called out to him saying, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. It's just as Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says, faith comes from hearing and hearing by the word of God. Many of the people of the town of Jericho and many other places saw Jesus with their own eyes. They witnessed his miracles. They should have known he was the Savior that had been promised so many centuries before. But they refused to believe in him to their eternal damnation in hell. Matthew chapter 11, verses 20 through 22 tells what will happen to the people who saw him and saw his great miracles yet refused to believe in him. Those verses say, then he began to reprimand the cities in which most of his miracles were done because they did not repent. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles that occurred in you had occurred in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Nevertheless, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Solomon or for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. What will happen to people today who have so many chances to hear the word of God and read the word of God, yet refuse to do it as they continue on in their unbelief, rejecting God's offer of salvation in Jesus? Many are waiting for proof that Jesus is the Savior. They will be waiting until judgment day when they will see Jesus as their judge, who will say to unbelievers, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire which was prepared for the devil and his angels. We can learn so much from blind Bartimaeus. Even though he couldn't see physically, he still knew that Jesus was his Savior from sin and called out to him for help. Bartimaeus was completely helpless. He knew he totally depended on Jesus to receive his sight and to be forgiven and have eternal life with God. It is the same also for us today. We are totally dependent on Jesus to save us from our sins. We sin against God every day. We need forgiveness for countless sins. We cannot even pay for one sin, let alone a whole lifetime of sins. The good news is that Jesus did it all for us. His death on the cross has paid for all of our sins, and we are set free. We were blind spiritually, but through the Word and sacraments, He has brought us to see that we need a Savior, and that the Savior is Jesus. He is our all-sufficient Savior. Just like Bartimaeus, we call out to God saying, "Lord, have mercy." You notice in this passage that when the people tried to stop Bartimaeus from calling out to Jesus, that he only shouted out all the more, saying, "Son of David, have mercy on me." He was determined to get to Jesus because he knew that Jesus was his only hope. We see in the great love that Jesus had for Bartimaeus, the love that he has for all people, he loved each of us so much that he died a horrible death on the cross that we might live with God forever in heaven. Luke chapter 19, verse 10 says that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. He also promises to be with us in this life. The Bible says to pray about everything. Nothing is too big or too small to pray about. He is never too busy to hear us. Bartimaeus didn't waste any time. When Jesus called to him, he threw aside his cloak, jumped to his feet, and came to Jesus. That cloak was possibly all that Bartimaeus owned. It meant nothing to him in comparison to getting to Jesus. He knew that Jesus was all that he needed. No matter how much of the world's goods we have, it is all garbage in comparison to knowing the Savior. Paul, at one time before he met Jesus, had it made as far as the world was concerned. He was wealthy, he had a high position in the church, he was a Roman citizen with all of its privileges. After he came to know Jesus, he considered all of that before as garbage in comparison to knowing Jesus. What a wonderful invitation Jesus gives to each of us today. Jesus says to all people, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Nothing would stop Bartimaeus from getting to Jesus. Nothing should stop us from getting to Jesus. And we have so many opportunities to hear God's word in church and to receive Jesus' body and blood in the Lord's Supper, which strengthens our faith. We could read God's word at home. How could anyone throw away such wonderful gifts from God? We have nothing to offer God, but He offers us everything. And when we know of His great love for us as seen in Jesus' death on the cross for us, how could we refuse? And you notice what Bartimaeus asked for in this passage. He didn't pray for big money or for some selfish worldly thing, but he asked for his eyes to be healed. And it was his faith that gave him his eyesight. His faith also gave him eternal life in heaven. Isaiah prophesied about what the Savior would do when he came to the world. 700 years before Jesus came, Isaiah said that the Savior would be a light to the nations. He would give sight to the blind, bring prisoners out of the dungeon, and those living in darkness out of prison. Of course, Bartimaeus' faith did not save him because it was a good work on his part, but his faith saved him because it connected him to Jesus, the Son of God, and the Savior of the world. Faith saves because it receives the gifts that Jesus gives to those who believe. And Bartimaeus' faith then caused him to follow Jesus. Those who truly believe in Jesus will want to follow him and learn more about him. Jesus would soon go to Jerusalem to die for the sins of Bartimaeus and for the sins of the whole world. He would go right into the place where his enemies wanted him dead. But he did that we might live with God forever in heaven. John 5:24 says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life." Two verses from hymn number 575 say, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. No merit of my own I claim, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, clothed in his righteousness alone, redeemed to stand before his throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." We pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Thank you for viewing Main Street Living this morning. Our hope is that you have been blessed and encouraged by this presentation. If you are able to attend local services, I would like to invite you to worship with our congregation. If you are in the Belle Fourche area, please join us at Trinity Lutheran Church, Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. This broadcast is supported by viewers like you, and their financial help allows this broadcast to continue. You can join us by sending a contribution of any amount to this address. More information about this program can be found at mainstreetliving.com, including links to other LCMS websites, congregation locations, and additional ways to donate. Thank you again for joining us today, and have a blessed week. We hope to see you again at the same time next Sunday on this station.